This is Russell Brennan, producer of Themes from the 60s Volume 1, and here's the story behind the scenes about this classic album that started a trend. Themes from the 60s. This is the story. How did it come about? Why did it set a trend? Well, back in my youth, I managed a record shop, and everybody used to come in saying, you got Man from U.N.C.L.E., Mission Impossible, Batman, etc., and you just couldn't get them on singles. So therefore, I knew there was a sort of a market for it, and the only compilations you could get was easy listening ones that had Sports Night, Coronation Street, this sort of thing, and maybe the Avengers theme, and people say, I don't want to buy that just for the Avengers theme. So some years later, I got my own record label, Future Legend Records, and I decided, since I knew all the great track listings that people were into for cult themes from the 60s, especially in the cult shows, what I put together a compilation of just the right themes. However, rather than be lazy and just license the originals, I thought, what a new indie label was about breaking new artists. So I decided, let's put the two ideas together, do new versions of cult TV and film themes to help break new artists. Then, because I was not too shabby at arranging songs and producing them, I worked on all the tracks to give them a certain feel that became identifiable over the years. And so Themes from the 60s was born in 1993. It came out, and it had tracks like Mission Impossible, Man from U.N.C.L.E., the Avengers theme to Serve with Love, Magic Secret Service, The Prisoner, Up the Junction, You Only Live Twice, Batman, and so on. So first thing I'll probably mention is Sleep, because to some people the sleeve might look a bit dodgy. Well, I was giving a talk in a school about inspiring people to do art and music, and someone said, why don't you give some school kids a chance to do something? So I said, alright, the best person who can design me a sleeve for Themes from the 60s will use it for her first album. So a 15 year old schoolgirl designed this Themes from the 60s, and it's not perfect, but that worked in our favour, believe it or not, because amongst the racks of records, because it was on CD as well as vinyl and cassette at the time, was loads of colour CD covers. And I want to ask people which one jumps out at you in the CD rack as you're just passing by to grab your attention. 9 out of 10 people point to the black and white one, said, oh, that's the one, just to see what that is, because it stands out from the rest. And also because it doesn't look perfect, some other people said it didn't look quite right, something about it, so they were drawn to it from that point of view. So the sleeve, far from being not that good, it proved to be very successful, and it captured the art feel of the 60s as well, which is good. So next I went about finding the bands, and because I was on the mod scene at the time and I produced Cult Hour, Stellan and Rigby, just towards the end of her career, we decided, I said she should do a few cult themes like You Only Live Twice and Up the Junction, because it was to her voice. So those were the first two recorded for it. And then there was, she decided to up and disappear, and you can hear her story on the Future Legend website. It's one of the most unusual and interesting pop stories you'll hear about when you check out Eleanor Rigby on the Future Legend Records website. Anyway, so we did hers, then there was kind of a bit of a break, and then, as I say, I ended up getting a new label, Future Legend, and started recording all the different tracks. And then I went to Sony and said, this will do well, because I'd also run around the fan clubs. I was a member of the Prisoner fan club. I used to go to Gerry Anderson conventions and stuff like that. So I knew there was a big market for it, but Sony said, oh, this will be lucky to sell 300 copies, but I knew better. And went on to sell many, many thousands of copies, and they offered me a job working for them. And I said, no, you don't know what you're doing, but we do, so I'll stick with doing my own thing. Thank you very much. So now we come to the track listing and a bit of behind the scenes banter about the track listing. So here we go. The Avengers theme. Well, when Eleanor Rigby used to be touring around Europe, she was a bit like a blonde version of cross between Emma Peel and Debbie Harry, I suppose you could call it. And and also she had a backing band called Grave, and in order to give them their 5 minutes of fame, we thought, let them do a track on their own. And so the ideal track seemed to be the Avengers theme. So they'd play the Avengers theme on their own, the band called Grave, and then she'd come on and do her set of all her original kind of songs and stuff like that. And so it was an obvious choice for the Grave to come and do the Avengers theme for this album. And so they are predominantly Eleanor Rigby's backing band, and they do the Avengers theme. Studio 68, starting to make a name for themselves, and I liked what they sounded like, and I said, what track would you like to do? And they said To Sir With Love, which I thought was a bit unusual because it's sung from a girl's point of view, so some might say it had gay connotations, but as far as I know, none of the band are gay. So I thought, what the hell, let's give it a go. And between us we arranged the song, and it proved very popular. But the band didn't last long, but the lead main person in the band, Paul Moody, went on to be famous as a journalist for Melody Maker and NME. So there was obviously some talent there, and it was Paul decided it was as a writer as opposed to it being a musician. The next track again is very interesting. It's I was the editor of two fanzines, one called Dedicated Follower that was very popular, it was the best selling mod fanzine around the time, and it was featured in an exhibition at the Victoria and Albert Museum, where it's now housed as a testament to youth culture. Then I did another mod magazine on the side called The Britannia with the keyboard player of Eleanor Rigby's backing band, who was called Avril. She was only a 16-year-old girl, just left school, but we teamed up to be the editors of The Britannia, and that also proved popular. Because she was the keyboard player in Eleanor's band and I occasionally played drums, we just decided, why don't we do a track and put it under the name of The Editors, because that's what we were at the time. And so we decided to do On Her Majesty's Secret Service, which is obviously is a Bond theme. But because funds were low at the time, we just kind of jammed it in someone's living room on a 4-track player that you had back then for doing demos. And in fact, one of the tracks didn't even work. So it was actually done on 3 tracks and it was improvised in 1 take. And that's what eventually just came out on the record. And 2 very interesting stories came from that track. The first one is when I was going visiting record companies to get deals for other bands, I saw Nick Beggs, who used to be main force in Kajagoogoo, and he was A&R at Phonogram Records at the time, and he saw the cult themes in my case, and he saw I've got one of those, the themes from the 60s, so I really loved that On Her Majesty's Secret Service, brilliant recording. And I thought, well, it's funny, because at the time he was booking people into 48 track studios, and here was one done on 3 tracks, and he couldn't seem to tell the difference, or maybe just thought it was a brilliant production on 3-track, what can I say? Anyway, so that was the story of the recording, and years later, obviously, another band came out, just called Editors, and there was a bit of confusion, because they stole their name, they couldn't really use it, but we didn't bother pursuing them, because it was a one-off recording for us, but a number of people did think it was the Editors who came out later in the 90s. Or 2000s or whatever on this track, but it's in fact Avril and myself playing on that track. Another popular theme and popular show from the 60s is the Prisoner theme, and it had a great tune to it, so I thought, right, definitely want to do that one, and the fan club people were fanatical about anything to do with Prisoner, so I got a band, one of our bass players had a band on the side called Kitsch, and they decided to record it, and they started to record it, and they split up in the middle of recording. So effectively, I had a new band at the time called Box Office Poison, and we kind of ended up doing it, but the album sleeve had already been printed with Kitsch on it, so we just left it, but it's in effect, it's Box Office Poison doing the Prisoner theme. And we also went to film down the Prisoner Village to do a video, which you'll see in a minute.
I am not a number, I am a free man!
Suitcase. That, to me, this is one of my favourite themes and most underrated themes of the 60s, and years later Chris Evans used it for TFI Friday, but it's a great theme. But rather than just copy the original, you have to do something a bit different if you're going to do a cover. So I've kind of done a kind of almost classical version of it, which seemed to work, and this was with the prototype band that I had at the time that I mentioned a minute ago called Box Office Poison. And so we did a, like I said, almost classical version of Man in a Suitcase. Next we come to Eleanor Rigby's two tracks. As I say, I thought You Only Live Twice really suited her voice, as did Up the Junction. Up the Junction was more of an obscure song. It's from the 60s film starring Dennis Waterman, and it was originally done by Manfred Mann, and strangely enough it was the only one of their few tracks that wasn't a hit, and it was also one of the few tracks written by a band member who incidentally wrote loads of hits for other people that it couldn't seem to write for hits for his Manfred Mann, which is a story in itself. He wrote a song called Mr. You're a Better Man Than I for starters, anyway. So Up the Junction, and many people have heard this version of Up the Junction say it's the definitive version. It's a classy, one of my most classy productions, so check that out, and here's a video.
Days begun and people rush off to work by four tempers. Open eyes and open minds. Conditioned to the daily grind. Through the factory gates. place warm. Seem the clothes are worn by all. Overalls like uniforms. See the faces young and old, feeling every crack and bone. Some are floating in a dream, but I'll go through the same routine. Drifting in the human stream. Lots of people down the street meet friends and say hello. It's not as nice as yesterday, but better when there's on the wine. Up the junction.
Right, the most interesting track in some ways off this album is You Only Live Twice by Eleanor Rigby. It's got many stories connected with it. Firstly, Eleanor Rigby, it was her last ever recording, and she disappeared at the height of her popularity. So when we did the video for it, we ended up having to get a stand-in to do Pretend to Be Her. So, but the funny thing about this was she disappeared for a few years by the time this came out. And when the album came out, the radio stations were playing a few tracks off the album, but they really focused on You Only Live Twice. They all loved it, and everyone started playing it. And so Sony said, oh, there's a big demand for this as a single. So we put it out as a single, and then it went out on export around the world. And the next thing we know, we get a call from a fan saying, did you know you're number one in Italy? And we thought, no. So they sent us a photograph of the chart or something, and there she was, number one in Italy, which we found a bit hard to believe, because although it sold well in Italy, it didn't sell enough to be number one in our book. But we since discovered that the airplay chart in Italy, the chart in Italy was based on 90% airplay, 10% sales, so that's why it went to number one. And so there we was with a number one hit off this first album, and it also revitalised Eleanor Rigby's career, and she had the Best of Eleanor Rigby come out in 94, which influenced a lot of Brit poppers, and people like Blur were influenced by, and Shirley Manson said she was one of the best artists to come out. So there's a little video for her coming up, and you'll see why it's such a popular version of You Only Live Twice.
Oh,
but in recent weeks we've had the new Man from U.N.C.L.E. film with Guy Ritchie. I haven't got around to seeing it just yet, but I was a big fan of the original 60s TV series and it had a great theme. I believe it might have been written by Lalo Schifrin, perhaps. And then kind of decided, again, The Grave deserved another shot to do another track that they hadn't done before, so I decided I arranged the Man from U.N.C.L.E. in an interesting way, and they did it. Sounds very mod, very 60s. Under the name of Ministry of Defiance, because we were still a work in progress. And again, we followed this line of doing almost a classical version of the theme for Mission Impossible, as we had done with Man in the Suitcase. To have a Gerry Anderson one on, because I'm a big fan of all the Gerry Anderson shows like Thunderbirds and stuff. So, but on this one we decided to go for Stingray, and it's a really good version of Stingray. And I discovered a mod band from Wigan called CBU, who were really good, and they did the version of Stingray. But what I decided to do was mess about with being an innovative producer that I am. I decided to tell the band to all swap instruments. The drummer, who never sung before, decided to get him to do the singing. I've got the bass player to swap with the guitarist, and the guitarist to go onto the drums and just do the track and see what happened. And it actually came out really well, because what I noticed was when the normal singer sung it, it just did something wasn't working. It was too sung, if you get what I mean. And so we decided, let's have someone who can't sing so well, and it just happened to work. And so, and I've since heard that David Bowie used to do things like that, but I like to try like sort of wacky ideas out in the recording studio, and I did loads of wacky ideas for cult themes in the 60s volume 2, which I'll probably make a little interview for in the future, and particularly the Doctor Who track I did for volume 2 is very fascinating.
Anything could happen in the next half hour.
Signed up for this album was a band called Perestroika, and it was strange how this came about. because I'd written a book called Music Business Bastards, How to Do Well in the Music Business Without Getting Ripped Off. And an ITV show called Motormouth wanted to do kind of a documentary based on the book. And they said, you say you can get bands and take them from nowhere to be successful. And I said, yeah, if they've got the talent. So they put a stack of CDs and tapes in front of me and said, just pick one out at random. And that's the one we want you to turn into a success. And I picked out one. They were called Gold Against the Grey. And I thought, well, that's a bad name. And the photos of them looked like bank clerks from a bank. So I didn't really have a good image either. But I listened to the tape and looked up, sounded okay, they weren't too bad, but the original material was a bit, the recording wasn't so good, it kind of was all at one level, not very exciting. So I said, alright, I'll give it a go. So then I got together with the band and I come up with a new name and image. I gave them a Russian peasant image, and then I did some photos of them to look like Russian peasants, along with one of the co-owners of the label, Anne Bygrave, who also did photos of the band. And then I changed their name to Perestroika to go with the Russian image, then produced some tracks for them, like A Love Song, which is a obscure Simple Minds track, and another one called Good Earth, which was one of their own tracks. And all of a sudden, we did a new package, they started to get lots of interest and management, but then they all kind of had a bit of a problem. First of all, the guitarist, who was happy being the big shot in his local town, the big time seemed to frighten him, so he kind of took off and left the band. The keyboard player was female, she wanted to get married for ages, and her boyfriend didn't seem too bothered about getting married, but once she started getting a lot of interest by being in a band, he suddenly proposed to her and gave her an ultimatum, the band or the marriage, and she decided, oh, she wants to get married, so she left, and her friend, one of the other girls in the band, she was only in the band because her friend was a keyboard player, so she left. Then the drummer had stayed for a little while, but ended up just being the bass player, and who was also the singer, but he was the driving force in the band, but he ended up being a solo kind of thing. And people lost interest in the band because they'd split up, and then the TV show kind of lost their franchise or something, so that didn't happen either. So in order to give the guy some compensation, because he'd been working hard, I said, I'll tell you what, I'm just doing this cult themes thing. We've got one track left to do, The Addams Family. Do you fancy doing it? So he said, yeah, if you do it with me. So between the two of us, under the name Perestroika, a guy called Kevin Dodd, who was the lead singer of Perestroika, we did The Addams Family, and that one came out all right as well.
They do what they want to do.
Anybody who was in a recording studio at the time kind of just jammed it from different bands, and I was on it, Avril was on it, Eleanor was on it, you name it. And even I think the lady that swept up the recording studio did some backing vocals. So it's pretty much a jam, and it's a very fun version of the Batman theme. And recently Sky Sports has been using it for trailer and some of their programs, so still popular 20 years on. So that's the Batman theme. Batman. fascinating stories between it, why all the tracks came about and the bands and so on. But that's the basic story about cult themes from the 60s. And as a footnote to it, like I said, it ended up selling thousands of copies, and then we put out Volume 2 that also did really well. As I say, I'll probably do another interview about that soon. And some DJs called Kaminsky Brothers started playing it, both these albums a lot at Madame Jojo's in London and a club in Manchester. And then people started turning up dressed as Lady Penelope, James Bond and so on. And my albums that I've produced and some of the tracks they were playing, the lifestyle, the DJs, the clubs, it all became somewhat of a trend by the time I got around to this one, which was themes from the 60s Volume 1. It was at the height of this cult themes thing that I'd helped start and became very popular, and it became a trend in the 90s. And then that kind of morphed into an easy listening thing with the likes of Mike Flowers and so on doing Wonderwall, and I decided that's gone as far as it could go. But there was a sting in the tail because I was persuaded to come back for the 70s, but that's for another documentary and another interview. For now, it's themes from the 60s that seems to be getting a revival at the moment. You can, sadly, it's sold out on CD, vinyl and cassette, but you can get it on download. And you can get selected tracks like the Eleanor Rigby tracks and even the Man from Uncle One on CDs at Future Legend Records website, but predominantly most of the album is now on a download at iTunes, Amazon and all good download stores. So that's the story of themes from the 60s. Hope you enjoyed it. This is Russell Brennan. It's been good to speak to you. Be seeing you.